Hello friends, welcome to NIOS Studio. Today I, Dr. Upasana Ray, shall discuss with you child rights violation in school and society. Now, we shall start with child rights violation and what it is. Child rights violation isn't a phenomena triggered by a single factor, but in fact, interplay of multiple catalysts. These factors are interlinked, which means that a substantial defense of child rights will require not only comprehensive policy reforms, but unprecedented attempts at changing people's psyche towards the right of the child. What is child abuse? In 1999, the WHO, World Health Organization, consultation on child abuse prevention compared definitions of abuse from 58 countries and drafted the following definition. Child abuse or maltreatment constitutes all forms of physical and or emotional ill-treatment, sexual abuse, neglect or negligent treatment or commercial or other exploitation resulting in actual or potential harm to the child's health, survival, development or dignity in the context of a relationship of responsibility, trust or power. What are the types of child abuse? The very first is physical abuse, the next being sexual abuse, third emotional abuse, fourth neglect and last child labor. What is physical abuse? Physical abuse is any non-accidental injury to a child under the age of 18 years by a parent or caretaker. These injuries may include beatings, shaking, burns, human bites, strangulation or immersions in scalding water or others with resulting bruises and welts, fractures, scars, burns, internal injuries or any other type of injury. Emotional abuse. Emotional abuse includes the failure of a caregiver to provide an appropriate and supportive environment and includes acts that have an adverse effect on the emotional health and development of a child. Such acts include restricting a child's movements, denigration, ridicule, threats and intimidation, discrimination, rejection and other non-physical forms of hostile treatment. It also includes a chronic pattern of behaviors such as belittling, humiliating and ridiculing a child. How do we define child sexual abuse? By definition, we may say a child sexual abuse is the exploitation of a child or adolescent for the sexual gratification of another person. Trafficking of children, particularly for sexual exploitation, is another offense. Children are today treated like objects, but the nature of this crime makes it hard to track in India. This is why India is not only a hub but simultaneously a transit point for child trafficking via Nepal and Bangladesh. There are three reasons behind India's child trafficking problem. The first, rampant poverty and lack of opportunities. Parents sell their children for merely a handful of rupees. Second, child trafficking as a highly profitable, albeit illegal business, which has buyers from across the world. It is the third most profitable organized crime business, generating billion-dollar revenues annually. Third, vulnerability of the child and lack of enforcement of child rights. Sexually abusive behaviors include voyeurism, fondling, child prostitution, child pornography, intercourse, sodomy, oral genital stimulation, verbal stimulation and examinations. Neglect. So what is neglect? Neglect refers to the failure of a parent to provide for the development of the child, but the parent is in a position to do so in one or more of the following areas: health, education, emotional development, nutrition, shelter and safe living conditions. Neglect is thus distinguished from circumstances of poverty in that neglect can occur only in cases where reasonable resources are available to the family or caregiver. Child labor. According to a 2015 report by the US Department of Labor, a list of goods produced by child labor or forced labor featured India among 74 countries with significant incidence of critical working conditions. It is not rare to find thousands of children toiling in the fields for 14 to 16 hours a day in labor-intensive professions like farming, stone-cutting sector, mining industry, and zari and embroidery. Forced displacement caused by development projects, including special economic zones, migration to urban areas, farmer suicides, and armed conflict is also another cause of child labor. Risk factors of child abuse. The high crime rate, the high poverty rate, and high unemployment rate. Indicators of child abuse. The first, we shall discuss the type of abuse, the physical indicators, and the behavior indicators. Let us take first the physical abuse. Under physical abuse, unexplained bruises, welts, burns, fractures, or bald patches on scalp are physical indicators. The behavioral indicators are way of adult contact, frightened of parents or afraid to go home, withdrawn or aggressive, moves uncomfortably, wears inappropriate clothes for weather. Second, we shall discuss sexual abuse. Indicators of child abuse are difficulty walking or sitting, torn or stained blood underclothes, pain, itching, bruises, swelling in genital area, frequent urinary or yeast infections. Behavioral indicators, advanced sexual knowledge, promiscuity, sudden school difficulties, self-imposed social isolation, avoidance of physical contact or closeness and depression. Third, emotional abuse, speech or communicative disorder, delayed physical development, exacerbation of existing condition, and substance abuse. What are the behavior indicators of emotional abuse? Habit disorder, antisocial and destructive behaviors, neurotic traits, behavioral extremes, and developmental delays. Neglect. Under physical indicators of neglect, we have consistent hunger, poor hygiene, inappropriate dress, unattended medical problems, underweight, and failure to thrive. Under behavior indicators, we may state self-destructive behavior, begging or stealing, food, constant fatigue, assuming adult responsibilities or concerns, frequently absent or tardy, states no caretaker in home. Common features of successful child abusive prevention programs. The first is strengthen the family and community connections and support. Second, treat parents as vital contributors to their children's growth and development. Create opportunities for parents to feel empowered to act on their own behalf. Respect the integrity of the family. Enhance parents' capability to foster the optimal development of their children and themselves. Violation of rights in schools. Schools means any public or private pre-kindergarten, elementary school, secondary school, technical school, vocational school, college, university, or institution of post-secondary education. What are the rights that are often violated in the school? The first, right to free and compulsory education. There should be no charges, direct or indirect, for primary education. Education must gradually be made free at all levels. Right to non-discrimination. Schools must not make any distinction in provision based on sex, race, color, language, religion, political opinion, nationality, ethnicity, ability, or any other status. Even at birth, India's masses prefer a boy over a girl. Girls in India are given less food, including access to breastfeeding, fewer healthcare consultations, making anemia and mineral deficiency common. Despite high female literacy, Delhi, Gujarat and Rajasthan still show discrimination against girls. The next kind of discrimination that we can discuss is people belonging to the SCs and ST criteria. They have faced discrimination throughout generation, and this trend is prevalent even to this day. Right to adequate infrastructure. There should be an appropriate number of classrooms accessible to all with adequate and separate sanitation facilities for girls and boys. Schools should be built with local materials and be resilient to natural risk and disasters. Right to quality trained teachers. Schools should have a sufficient number of trained teachers, of whom a good proportion are female. Teachers should receive good quality pre-service and in-service training with built-in components on gender sensitivity, non-discrimination and human rights. All teachers should be paid domestically competitive salaries. Right to safe and non-violent environment is another right that is often violated. Children should be safe on route to and in school. Clear anti-bullying policies and confidential systems for reporting and addressing any form of abuse or violence should be in place. Right to relevant education. The curriculum should not discriminate and should be relevant to the social, cultural, environmental, economic, and linguistic context of learners. Right to know your rights. Schools should teach human rights education and children's rights in particular. Learning should include age-appropriate and accurate information on sexual and reproductive rights. Right to participate. Girls and boys have the right to participate in decision-making processes in school. Appropriate mechanisms should be in place to enable the full, genuine and active participation of children. Right to transparent and accountable schools. Schools need to have transparent and effective monitoring systems. Both communities and children should be able to participate in accountable governing bodies, management committees, and parent groups. Another right that is commonly violated is right to quality learning. Girls and boys have a right to quality learning, learner-centered approaches, learning style-centered strategies, and to effective teaching processes so that they can develop their personality, talents and physical and mental abilities to their fullest potential. Corporal punishment. Corporal punishment is another thing that is a must and should be avoided at any cost from any school. Violation of any kind to this is severe. Corporal punishment of children in the form of hitting, punching, kicking or beating. In many, it is a significant phenomena in schools and others. Traditionally, teachers did not consider it an offense by hitting, punching, kicking or beating a student. But today, any kind of punishment as such is punishable on the part of the teacher. Role and functions of the teachers. First, provide care basic survival needs such as food, clothing and shelter to the students. Second is education. Third, prevent abuse in all forms, physical, sexual and emotional. Report suspected cases of abuse. Prevent child labor. Seek assistance for the state where needed. Lifesavers. Always as a teacher, remember that you will not ever do certain things. So what are the things that you should never, never do? The first, never leave your class unattended. Never ignore your students. Even if your students need to say the smallest thing to you, please pay attention to what your student is trying to tell you. Never disregard dramatic change in a student's behavior. Never scold a child who complains of being sexually molested. And always, always remember to teach children to shout or scream for help when in danger. Always remember to teach students to run away from persons who are acting suspiciously. Always remember to teach them to say no to strangers offering goodies and car rides. Always remember to pay attention when children confides in you. Always remember to teach them to speak out when someone touches them in a way that makes them feel uncomfortable. As a teacher, you should always treat children fair. You must not discriminate among the children in your class. Be very careful and refrain from calling them names. Calling names is often labeling a child. So, unknowingly, you may be causing harm to the child. If at all possible, avoid any and every kind of corporal punishment. Use positive and not negative reinforcement. As an overview of this session, we may say that child rights are often violated in both societal aspect and in schools. This particular session has been to make you aware of how the rights of the child are often violated in the society and how they are often violated in the school, knowingly or unknowingly. It also teaches you the do's and don'ts as a teacher so that the child rights can be preserved in the society as well as in the subsystem of the society, that is the school. Thank you.